Well, I would like to thank Ivan for the introduction, for the invitations, so to Frank and the other organizers. So it's great to be here. It's my first time here. So the topic of my talk is actually parabolic equations, so not really connected with wave phenomenon. However, what I will discuss is blow-up phenomenon. So that, of course, as it has been deeply studied already, it has a lot of parallels with singularity formation in parabolic problems, except that here the mechanism that triggers it is diffusion. So I will mention next three problems, yeah, that have rather similar features. Of course, with a lot of technical differences, one with respect to each other, but with a common flavor. I will only have time to speak about one of them. So I prefer to say a little bit more about one of them specifically. So one of the problems, one of the examples, actually, of the type of phenomenon I would like to see where perhaps it is easier to explain what happens is, say the three problems that I'm going to mention are actually have been studied a lot. They are quite standard in the literature. Say one of them is the reaction diffusion equation with this special power, which is the critical Sobolev exponent. Say we can consider, for instance, the problem of finding positive solutions in the domain, maybe with boundary conditions, and define up to some time capital T that could even be infinity. So a second problem, which is the one I will really talk about, is the harmonic map flow into S2, from R2 into S2. This is the special case. This is a special case, of course, the flow of harmonic maps, say the evolution problem for harmonic maps. But in the case of values in S2, it takes a particularly simple form, which is this semilinear equation, where the nonlinearity carries this gradient square term, and some special feature that is actually preserved along the flow is the fact that the absolute value of U is 1. So U really has values into S2. So we will consider this problem in a bounded domain, omega, although most of what I will mention is valid also in entire space, or certain classes of unbounded domains, but doesn't really matter, and up to a finite time t. I will consider this problem with a given boundary condition and corresponding initial data. So a third problem that of this type is the Keller-Siegel equation. The Keller-Siegel equation is an unlocal equation, if you want, or a system. So this is simply the heat equation, the standard heat equation, modified by a drift operator that depends on U and on this V. And what is this V? This V is inverse Laplacian of U, which by definition, for me, will be simply the convolution of U with the fundamental solution. This is a two-dimensional problem, which you can also write. You can also write this problem in divergence form like this. Okay, what do these problems have in common? One of them, one very important and that make the problems somehow nice, is the fact that they all have Lyapunov functionals. Actually, this is valid not just for the critical power, but for any power you wish, formally. Say this functional, defined like this, it's a Lyapunov functional. In fact, it is strictly decreasing unless we are at steady states, at least we're standing at steady states. And more precisely, it's just a computation, formal computation tells us that the derivative in time of this guy is going to be minus integral of ut squared, so it's negative. So similar feature we have for the harmonic mass flow. Harmonic mass flow, by definition, actually, is del 2 gradient flow, or del 2 negative gradient flow, for the Dirichlet integral. Yeah? For here in CCU has values into S2. And again, we have the same characteristic for E2. So E2 is strictly decreasing along solutions, along smooth solutions of it, non-trivial solutions, non-static solutions. And, well, perhaps a little bit more complicated, but still similar, is the Keller-Siegel system, the Keller-Siegel equation, the Keller-Siegel non-local equation, which can be written in this form, as I mentioned. And it turns out that the Lyapunov functional is given by this quantity, which is a little bit different. Now, the derivative of this guy along solutions, along smooth solutions, is negative. But now, the right-hand side is given by this. Okay, so this is one feature. Yeah, this is one feature, the fact that they have this structure, this variational structure. Yeah, but another one that they share that is very special for these problems is the following. It's the presence of a special family of steady states. As a matter of fact, a continuum of steady states, but a continuum of steady states depending on scaling parameter. The three problems have special scaling invariances. And that asymptotically becomes singular. Say, what do I mean? I mean, let us consider this, which is a special solution of this entire space. Well, in fact, all solutions of this can be written as a translation and a scaling of this function. So they are all given by this formula. This is known. The positive solutions, I mean. And a characteristic they have is that they all have the same energy that I wrote before. So it's actually constant along this scaling. So we have energy invariant family, an energy invariant continuum of steady states, which as the parameter takes to the limit to lambda going to zero, say this function becomes singular. Of course, away from the origin, this goes to zero, but exactly at the origin, this is 1 over lambda raised to the power, it goes to infinity, so it has spike form. So like that. Okay, so what is the corresponding object that I will consider? Because it's not the only one, unlike the critical exponent equation. Say, an object that seems to play a similar role is the following. This is a harmonic map. This function is a harmonic map. A harmonic map is, by definition, a steady state of the harmonic map flow. And this function indeed solves this elliptic equation. Yeah, with absolute value 1. We call it the one corrotational harmonic map, or the standard one corrotational harmonic map. Again, we have the same type of translation invariance. We also have a dilation invariance. If you simply scale the argument of it, the energy is preserved. The energy meaning the Dirichlet integral this time. No lambdas in front, of course, because you have values in each one. But there is an extra invariance that is this. Say if you rotate, the U is a vector, so it's an element in S2. If you rotate it by an orthogonal transformation of R3, then you still get a solution of the equation, and they all have the same energy once more. And as lambda goes to zero, this of course does not blow up itself. It has absolute value 1, but what blows up here is its gradient. Yeah, the gradient of U is actually going to infinity. Now, what is the corresponding object in the Keller-Siegel system? In the Keller-Siegel system, say in the Keller-Siegel equation in R2, a natural object to refer here is this function. And this function has, again, the characteristic that if you scale it now this way, you still get a solution. And this scaling preserves, again, the energy, this funny energy I wrote at the beginning. Yeah, that is. They have an additional feature that they all have mass 8 pi. Okay. So what is the topic of this talk? The topic of this talk, or actually the issue that I would like to analyze for the three problems, but in reality we'll refer only to the second one now, is the construction of solutions that have blow-up phenomenon, that exhibit blow-up phenomenon as T approaches a finite time or even infinite time. And what is the special pattern of blow-up that these equations exhibit, or that is already more or less known, that the blow-up arises, that there is blow-up arising in this way, is precisely like this. Say, is precisely in the form of blow-up around a finite number of points, maybe one or maybe more, where the profile of blow-up near each of the blow-up points is a scaling asymptotically singular, or resembles the scaling an asymptotically singular scaling of a steady state, of one of these energy preserving steady states. This is not so crazy, because since the energy is preserved, say the energy of an object like I am picturing here actually gets stabilized, yeah, because the scaling doesn't change the energy. So this is what is special in these problems. That's a feature sometimes called criticality, as a matter of fact, in this setting. Okay, so now I would like to refer to the harmonic map flow from R2 into S2. Then I consider this this problem, which from now on I will call HMF. So I consider this parabolic equation up to some given finite time capital T in a bounded domain, or in entire R2. But if omega is not the whole space, I consider boundary conditions and an initial condition. So of course, both the initial and the boundary condition have to go into S2. If that's the case, that property of having absolute value 1 is indeed preserving along the flow. Okay, so there is a lot of literature around this problem. In fact, I would like to make like a sort of review of known results. A lot of people have worked on this since long ago. The harmonic map flow was introduced not just in the setting, the two-dimensional setting, but as the L2 gradient flow or L2 negative gradient flow for the Dirichlet integral for maps between two more general Riemannian manifolds. And it was introduced as a way to build harmonic maps in reality. So these flows was introduced by Ilsen and Sampson many years ago, 50 years ago. And concerning, for instance, the problem of existence, local existence in time of classical solutions, this was first seen by Ilsen and Sampson themselves, then Struve, and then for the case of compact manifolds, and for the case of the boundary value problem by Casey Chang, more or less in 85. Okay, so I repeat what I said before. Say the Dirichlet integral is actually strictly decreasing along non-trivial trajectory, non-steady trajectories, not stationary trajectories of the flow, and we have this identity. So the energy is decreasing, is decreasing along the flow. Along the flow, as long as the solution remains smooth. But something that became known is that in general we don't expect global existence of a smooth solution. That's typically not the case. Not typically, but it may not be the case. Say that the solutions remain smooth at all times, while this didn't really become known up to much later. However, Struve in 84, say this is an important result of the theory, actually proved the following, proved that even though the solution may develop singularities. Those singularities can more or less be understood. Yeah? And it can be understood enough in the case, so that the solution can actually be continued in a natural way. In fact, it can be continued in a way, continued as a weak solution. Yeah, it can be continued as an H1 weak solution, where the energy has discontinuities. The energy still decreases, but it has jumps. Yeah, this is what happens with the definition of Struve. Well, as a matter of fact, it turns out that only at a finite number of points in space-time, so only up to only for finite number of times, and for each of those times at a finite number of points, we can have blow up. And at those points, at those times, jumps down in the energy take place. There is this result by Freire in 2002. He proved that for a certain class of solutions where energy is decreasing even if it has jumps, this solution is unique. So that means that the definition of Struve is in a way a good definition. More recently, I don't remember exactly the reference, but very recently, a student of Struve proved that if the jumps, the solution may not have decreasing jumps. Say, even if you have a weak solution with jumps in the energy that could even go a little bit up, but not too much, the solution is still unique. What I mean is that the jumps, as I will try to argue a little bit later, the jumps in the energy are quantized. In fact, in all examples known, this jump cannot be less than 4 pi. No? And I think this is a general fact, indeed. So this is Struve's solution, the energy in Struve's solution when you reach a singularity. Okay, so as I mentioned, U itself does not blow up, has norm one, has absolute value 1, but the gradient blows up when we have blow up. So in fact, if I call capital T the first time at which regularity is lost, which is strictly positive, as we know, we must have that the gradient goes to infinity as T goes from below to the blow up to the time capital T. Well, I will mention, although maybe the statement is not completely precise, I will state a property that is a summary of results by several people who work on this in the 80s and 90s, starting with Struve and several other authors that I mentioned here. So the question is, how does the solution looks like when it blows up? And it turns out that quite a bit of it can be said. The solution actually does blow up, if it blows up, it blows up in the form that I mentioned before, namely as scalings around a finite number of points of steady states UI, which are not necessarily the U that I wrote before. More precisely, the result, the statement is a little bit weaker, but still quite a strong assumption. If we approach capital T along a sequence, then I can extract a subsequence such that for a finite number of points Q1 up to Qk, the following holds. U along that sequence resembles an H1 function plus the sum of these bubbles. This is the subtraction of the value at infinity of the bubble, which makes sense. Where this guy say this is just a renormalization, where this actually goes to zero, this difference, say pointwise away from the points qi. Qin is approaching each of the qi's, and these lambda i's go to zero. In fact, a little bit of important information can be obtained about the relation between the scaling parameters and the mutual distances of the points, which is this fact. These numbers here, for I different from j, go to infinity. What does this mean? What happens is that if the points, for instance, qi, are all well separated, one from each other, say this is automatically satisfied, doesn't matter what this is. This goes to infinity because this goes to zero, right? But it could be the case that all points qi or a finite number of them coincide. What this says is that if they coincide, for instance, then this goes to infinity, which means that the rates are not comparable. One of the rates is much smaller than the other. So if we scale around the point, that means that you see just a single object. Say, if you use lambda I or lambda j, you will just see one object. So this is what that property means. So the UIs, as I mentioned, are harmonic maps. So harmonic maps with finite energy in entire ones. So what I mean is the UIs are entire solutions of this equation with U is with values in S2 and with finite energy, which is natural. I mean, we are starting with a finite energy configuration, so in the limit we should see something with finite energy. This is also a standard fact, is that U is a function that goes from R2 into S2, but I could regard it after stereographic projection as a function from R2 into R2, or from the complex numbers into the complex numbers, or with the composition in the other way, from S2 into say, I can regard it as a function from complex to complex, or from S2 into S2. So this is known. This is a known fact. These maps are conformal and in S2, and that makes when it is lifted to S2, it becomes a smooth function. So that in particular the value u at infinity, say infinity is one of the poles, say in S2, is well defined. Some fact that is known is that u is in correspondence in the complex numbers with a rational function, and in fact this also holds. So if we compute again by conformality in S2, say the integral of gradient u squared turns out to be a multiple of 4 pi. Say 4 pi is the area of S1 of S2. So it's an integer times the area of S2, and this fact holds for some m in the natural numbers. So in particular, the least energy non-trivial harmonic maps, non-constant harmonic maps, have energy 4 pi. So this is the reason of the 4 pi I mentioned before, I think. So in particular, say, what are we going to have? We are going to have that this u along Tn goes weakly to u star in H1. And the energy, say the defect with respect to the gradient of u star squared, are precisely asymptotic for the Dirichlet measure, is given by this asymptotically. Simply integer multiples of 4 pi's times Dirac deltas at the corresponding blow-up points. So this is a way to visualize quickly what the statement says. Okay. So, of course, there are many questions around it. This is a very interesting phenomenon. By the time of Struve's results or the many others that I mentioned, it was not really so much known about existence, for instance, of such patterns or further properties of it. Stopping in 2004 proved this very interesting fact. Prove that the rates at which the lambda i's, remember, are these blow-up rates around each of the bubbles in this decomposition. This is what I mean. So what Topping proved is say along subsequences, but I mean, doesn't matter. He proved that these blow-up rates have to be of this form. So they go to zero faster than t minus t to power 1/2. In fact, the estimate he finds, I think, is a little bit better, say, with the log in the denominator. But what this says, in the language of this type of geometric problems, or actually of many singularity formation phenomena, what this says is that the singularities developed must necessarily be of type 2. Type 2 means a singularity that cannot be captured with a subsimilar form. Yeah, this is more or less what it means. And the right rate for that in the harmonic map flow is this 1/2. So lambda I actually goes to zero faster than that. This is also valid in more general targets, not just in S2. In fact, Topping finds examples that show that this estimate is in fact optimal or approximately optimal. Yeah, there are examples for which of manifolds for which you can get blow-up rates as t minus t to 1/2 plus delta for any arbitrarily small delta. Okay. So what are the? Let me consider now the function u that I am calling from now on u zero. This standard harmonic map. This standard harmonic map actually when you is just lifting. Say this is a function from R2 into S2, but if you take it from R2 into R2. This is the identity. So this is just comes from a stereographic projection. Yeah. So these guys have exactly energy given by 4 pi, degree 1, if you want. Yeah. And the value at infinity of them are, of course, as you quickly see, is 0, 0, 1. So let me now mention what is it known concerning. Existence of blow-up patterns. In fact, there are very few examples known. And in fact, the examples known concern single blow-up points where the profile is like this. But more than that, the examples concern radially symmetric co-rotational, actually more precisely, radially symmetric settings, of which this is the only steady state. Let me be more precise. One co-rotational solution of the harmonic map flow is a solution that has this form. This is, of course, you know, in a spherical coordinates is a way to represent a vector, say in S2, a point in S2. And I assume that this angular variable. This angular variable is always e to the I theta in polar coordinates, where r and theta are the polar coordinates, and these functions are radially symmetric. So what is very nice is that with these ansatz, the harmonic map flow reduces to scalar equation. And this scalar parabolic equation is actually very simple. It's Vt equal 2d Laplacian, modified by this guy. Yeah. Which is sort of, by the way, Allen Kant type nonlinearity, but I will not really elaborate on all that. What something that can be observed is that this guy has the following steady state. The only monotone or finite energy or whatever steady state is given by decreasing. Say, okay, it's given by this function. This is explicit solution. Of stationary solution of the equation, and if we evaluate it with this v, say we obtain exactly the u zero that I mentioned before, the standard bubble. Okay, so concerning the literature, in fact, it had been as I saw in their paper, it had been actually previously conjectured that it may be the case that no blow up exists at all, that there's no blow up. In this 2D harmonic map flow, but Chang, Ding, and Ye in 1991 found a very nice example within the one co-rotational class In fact, what they are able to find is a solution of the scalar equation V, which looks like the steady state W, scaled this way, scaled by some small number lambda of t, or equivalently, say, for the actual original harmonic mass flow, the solution you associated looks like the U0 at x over lambda of t, yeah? Where this lambda of t goes to zero as t approaches capital T. So what they do is they, it's a very nice argument. They capture the blow up using barriers. So they prove that there is blow up using some special barriers, and those barriers are very sensitive to what the boundary conditions are. Yeah? So it is necessary to take the boundary conditions in certain range in order to observe the phenomenon. They take initial conditions zero and boundary values, say bigger than pi or less than pi, say. And they observe this phenomenon. Well, for the one co-rotational solution, this was proven many years later, 2009, Angenen, Hulshoff, and Matano found a much stronger estimate for this setting, for these special solutions, for this special harmonic mass flow into S2 and one co-rotational. The rate turns out to be much smaller than t minus t to 1/2. It turns out to be little order of capital T minus little t. Yeah, this is what they proved in 2009. Actually, before them, van der Werf, Hulshoff, and King in 2003 made a very, very wrote a beautiful paper, formal paper, in which they describe a lot of phenomena around the one co-rotational blow up, the blow up in the one co-rotational case. And what they discovered formally is that the blow up rate, oh, here is a mistake, important. Here is squared, there is a 2 there, not the 1. Yeah? It's very different life with the 2 than with the 1 in these rates, by the way. So what they discover is that lambda of t is of this order. So it's not just little order of t minus t, but actually modified with the log square in the denominator. So the result of Angenen, Matano, and Hulshoff is weaker than this statement, but of course it is a rigorous result. Yeah? And a result that that is much more recent, in fact I think the year is 2013, is due to Raphael and Schweyer. They prove a very important fact. They succeeded to make a construction of an actual solution, one co-rotational solution, that blows up exactly with this rate. Yeah? So the construction is very explicit. It's not based on barriers. It's actually machinery closer to the dispersive equations, to analysis of blow up in dispersive problems. And they found a very, very, very nice description of their solution with the right blow up. And they were able also to establish this very interesting fact. They proved that this rate, say, in the language, in the formal language of these authors, they say that they find the quotes generic rate. So they say the generic rate should be this with the 2. So what Raphael and Schweyer proved sort of that, but well, not exactly. What they proved is that for the solution they constructed, if they take small perturbations of the initial condition, for that special solution, then they still see the same phenomenon. I mean, they see still blow up with the same rate, of course at a slightly different time. Yeah. This is, I insist, in the one co-rotational radially symmetric class. So these are the examples known. Yeah, in the for the flow from R2 into S2, as far as we know. Now there are, of course, a natural question now is to investigate what happens in the non-radial situation, or in a situation where there are boundary conditions. In the case of the result I just mentioned, the setting was entire space. So the question is, natural question is, well, are there solutions that are in non-radial symmetric settings. For instance, is it possible to have more elements, like in Struve's decomposition, like the bubbling resolution, you know, like several bubbles in different places? Can you have towers of bubbles or bubble trees? I mean, etc. There are many questions around. Yeah, and of course the question of their stability, because it might perfectly be the case that the solution is stable within the radially symmetric class, but when you make perturbations which get off the radially symmetric class, perhaps the stability is destroyed. Our result, just as a summary, is the following. Say we prove that if we take any finite number of points of omega, in fact, I should say the following. Yeah, it's roughly this. You fix k points arbitrary. Then you can cook up initial conditions and boundary conditions independent of time, so that a blow-up solution with exactly those k given points exists. Yeah, this is essentially the result. And the profile is, like Raphael and Schweyer, scaling, or Zhang, Ding, and Ye, is a scaling of the U0 with rates that can be computed explicitly, and they coincide with the one formally derived and rigorously found by later. Yeah? And, you know, and this is also a kind of result that supports the quotes genericity statement, okay? At least the bubbling at one point, at exactly one point, is stable. Yeah. This, in fact, very connected with some work by Frank Merle and Hatem Zag in the subcritical heat flow, where solutions with finite number of points were found, arbitrary points in the domain. So the result shares the flavor. Okay, so. Very quickly, let me say how, yes?
When you had the initial cartoon of the multiple points, it looked like there was a hole in the domain.
Oh yeah. No, but there's no need of the hole, no. No, in fact, if you're looking for this type of phenomenon in elliptic problems, that where the bubbling is triggered by parameters, many times you need topology. So I actually borrow the picture from an elliptic setting. But many times you need some topological assumption to get multiple blow up. But here we don't need anything. A way to put it is that here we put all the blame in the initial condition. Say, all topology needed, say, is in the initial condition, which I don't say what it is.
The question is whether there's any numerics that shows this?
Actually, the only numerical result that we are aware of, in fact, provided evidence opposite to one of our claims, that was the that was the stability. In fact, there is a paper. There is a paper by Vanderberg, I think, and Williams that I learned from Peter, actually, that conjecture that numerically that if you destroy this, that if you destroy the symmetry, then the solution may blow up. The blow up may be destroyed, exactly the opposite. But say, okay, so as I mentioned, the energies of all these guys is 4 pi. Let me consider not just arbitrary rotations, arbitrary orthogonal transformations. I will consider special ones that correspond simply to rotate this vector around the y3 axis, yeah, which means if you write it in complex form, simply multiply the first two components written in complex as a complex number by e to the I alpha. Okay, so this is our more precise statement. What we are able to prove is the following. Given k points, you know, distinct points, there exists initial and boundary conditions such that the solution of harmonic map flow for those data blows up at exactly those k points. And the profile at those k points is given by, by a convergence to zero like this in H1 and uniform senses, H1 and uniform, where the bubbling takes the form of simply a suitable rotation around the axis times the corresponding scalings around QI, where now I put correctly the two, where the blow up parameters are like this. So we have in particular this energy formula. The uniform convergence, by the way, is a property in the bubbling decomposition. Let me mention something very quickly. When the time goes to infinity, so if you go actually along a Pallas-Mail sequence, say, for the flow, yeah, if you go along the solution, but for time going to infinity, in fact, other properties are known. For instance, this convergence to zero uniformly is sometimes called no-neck property. Yeah, so it is not known if this holds in general in the finite blow-up thing. Well, of course, when time goes to infinity, this guy sees a harmonic map. There is a paper by Peter Topic where it is proven that if towers are formed at infinity, then all the elements of the tower, except the first one, must be either holomorphic or conjugates of holomorphic at the same time, not holomorphic. I think that's the... Is that what you proved? No. Okay. So, so Rafael and Schwer, as I mentioned, proved the stability within the one co-rotational class. And here I mentioned this numerical work by van der Weyden and Williams. Let me mention the stability statement is a little bit more precise. For the single blow up, is stable in this sense. If you perturb the initial data, then you observe exactly the same phenomenon where, of course, these numbers, alpha I star, this cap I stars, and the time capital T, and the points QI, are slightly modified, as it is natural. And if you consider the blow-up point at exactly k points, that phenomenon is not stable, which is, no wonder. The blow-up points, the blow-up times may not coincide. This is what it means. But if you insist that the blow-up take place in exactly those k points, you can choose the initial data in a codimension k minus 1 manifold around the initial condition. Let me mention another issue that we find quite interesting that is also addressed in the formal paper by Vanderberg and Hulshoff and King, and in rigorous work by Peter, which is continuation after blow up by a mechanism called reverse bubbling. I will say very quickly what that is. What happens is that the definition of Struve, has this unpleasant feature that the energy jumps, okay? But the energy jumps means, a change in the homotopy class. It turns out that means a change in the homotopy class of the image of U, yeah? Change of degree, if you want, yeah? As you... Not just a change of degree, a change of homotopy class. So the question is, are there other type of continuations after blow up that are kind of nicer in the sense that they possibly preserve some of the topology of the manifold, of the original manifold? And Topping proposed a way to do this and prove that there is a continuation with this feature. In the one co-rotational case, he proved that Chang, Ding, and Ye solution can be continued with a profile very similar. However, with one difference, it's not the one co-rotational standard bubble what you see after the blow-up time, But after the blow-up time, you see the same thing, but in reverse orientation, the conjugate, if you want. Yeah, and that is this map. So asymptotically, it's the same. So this is 0-1, like the other. But around the origin, it winds in the opposite direction. So this type of procedure is what is called reverse bubbling. In the reverse bubbling has in the energy a feature that is different from Struve. In fact, it's nicer in a way because the energy in fact continues continuously except exactly at time t when it goes down and up. Remember that decreasing implies unique. But if you leave the decreasing, but you allow that there is a fixable discontinuity of the energy, then this solution does it. What we proved is that this continuation is possible for the solutions we built. In the solutions we built can be continued with exactly the same profile, except that after, when you go from above the blow-up time, say the solution is defined up to t plus some delta, and as you go down, you see this blow-up. So, concerning the construction, something that it may be reasonable to think is that this type of profiles that we build may actually be quite general. May even be generic, really. In the way blow up takes place. Why do we say this? It's not obvious at all. It's not obvious at all. But the question is it possible to have bubbles other than those induced by U0 or or its conjugate? Because there are other harmonic maps. There are K corrotational harmonic maps with higher degree. So is it possible that there are profiles like that? And it turns out that in the K corrotational class, which also leads to some similar scalar equation, it turns out that for high in the high correlational class, these authors, Wan, Gustafsson, and Tsai, proved that this is not possible. In fact, they proved that this was not possible for high correlational number, but they conjectured it is true also for lower ones. There is, I think it's Vanderberg or Vanderhout, the author. Sorry, I didn't include it. Actually, there are no bubble trees in finite time, so not ours. This is another thing. But just in the one correlational class. In the infinite time, Tobin found them. In the infinite time bubbling, there exists bubble trees, at least with some special right-hand sides, target manifolds. And other rates are also possible. They have been found by Rafael and Schweyer in the one correlational class, but they are non-generic. They come with different powers of t minus t. Sorry, this shouldn't be here. Anyway, let me in 1 second. Let me say how the solution we find is made. In fact, I don't have time to discuss it, unfortunately. Yeah, it was like for 2 talks, it seems. The solution is made in the following way, okay? The solution is made as the bubble, and actually this whole thing that I had written in the previous pages was to attempting to justify how the scaling parameter is chosen. And the way it is chosen is connected with the following. The initial condition is made in the following way, by the bubble, but plus some remainders. And these remainders are crucial. And what this does is to correct the error. What this term does is to correct the error due to the lambda far away. When you scale this, you create an error, okay? And this just corrects it far away. But this guy is less obvious, yeah? This is a function projected in the tangent space of the sphere, say the orthogonal to U, and this C star is a solution to heat equation. And this is a lower order term, yeah, that is explicit, but doesn't matter. So, and this guy has to have the following properties, is a vector field in R2, actually, with two components are zero. C star tilde is some C star, and with zero third component. And we need divergence positive, curl equal to zero, and value equal to zero. So you cannot put C star equal to zero. This is what I mean. Yeah, you really need this guy. You really need a perturbation of this type in order to find a reasonable equation for lambda. And that reasonable equation for lambda is an equation like this. It's an equation, it's a non-local equation. It's a non-local equation like this. And this non-local equation, when this guy is negative, is actually something that we cannot solve exactly, but we can solve approximately at a very high precision. Yeah? It looks like we cannot really solve it exactly. And this leads us to, this is not difficult to see. An equation like this leads, it's a non-local equation, but it leads us to a solution of this type where K is exactly proportional to the divergence of C star. So this is what, it was the first time I tried to give this talk, so it was too long. Okay, thank you very much.
Questions, comments?
The continuation with the reverse bubble,
yes.
Does it come as a limit of something? Some parameter goes to zero or whatever, or you just throw it out?
The construction is actually explicit. Say, let me put it this way. In the limit, you see the bubble, which exactly at time capital T you drop. Then you get a new function there, right? It's kind of smooth, yeah?
Yes. Let me precise the question. Then if you look to another PE which do not blow up and approximate that, what is the real limit?
I think that's a very good question. No, we have asked ourselves that question. Now I understood the question. Yes, we have asked.
One question is,
Is this the right continuation? I know what you mean. Yeah.
This one will dissipate the energy or will defocus right away? So we are always this.
I think it's a very good question. I mean, we have asked our question ourselves.
I'm sorry, what is the question?
No, the question is this. Say you regularize your flow. Say you put gradient u to power 2 minus epsilon or something like that. Yeah? I don't know if that's the right thing. So then you analyze what is happening around that blow up time for same initial conditions when you let epsilon go to zero. Say presumably the solution will blow up, but the question is, but the solution exists after also after blow up. So is the solution we are constructing the right limit? It's a good question. In fact, my opinion is yes, but my co-author's opinion is the opposite. But we don't really have a clear evidence to that.
Impossible to guess. You have to have a proof.
No, absolutely, absolutely. No, we don't know. This is somehow the choice that seems to make the energy more continuous. On the other hand, you know, if you the convergence is not so nice in a way, okay, because you have the bubble in one with one rotation up to the blow up time, but then the rotation changes direction. So it's, you go from degree 1 to minus 1. So there is a sort of discontinuity, even though the topology is preserved. Yeah?
Same degree. You just rotate more. 180.
Yeah. This. I'm sorry. This is what I mean. It's same degree. This is why the homotopy class is preserved. But if you see what is happening immediately after, immediately before, say there is no uniform convergence. Say the difference between time t plus epsilon and times t minus epsilon is not something that goes to zero.
Because he still has a question.
Yes.
Yeah. First, the fact that you have this change, I think it's similar to what Merck has in his continuation in the NLS, that it comes in and opens up. Yes, so you have this change of the plus going to minus and everything else.
Ah, no, I didn't think those terms could be. But you think so?
So what? It's unstable. Yeah, so the singularity is unstable.
Yeah. But what is missing here is something should be lost at the singularity, after the singularity.
Maybe.
And in your continuation, I didn't see anything get lost.
No, there's nothing lost, actually. Say, the energy is sort of continues nicely. It's not, there's nothing else. This is, Yeah, but this is a diffusion phenomenon, so maybe slightly different.
But, I'm thinking, okay, it could be possible, but anyway, okay, I don't know.
But it is a geometric equation, so you have some constraints coming from the geometry, so that's the reason why probably there is only a reasonable way of continuation.
It is possible. I don't know if you have. Do you have that opinion?
You, for example, you have different speed of defocusing, typically. So which one you choose?
Let me. This I didn't mention. When you construct the reverse bubbling, in fact, there are many reverse bubbling rates that you can get. In fact, the generic one is not this one. If you go from positive time to zero, you can construct a blow-up solution, but you can get other rates. And the typical rate is not with log square, but with log.
Yes,
so it's not...
It depends of your approximation. You can choose just one rate.
Yes, so the rate you choose may depend on it. I don't know. No, yeah, what do you say?
It depends on the approximation of your equation. The you don't have the freedom of the rate. This way to do it is just approximations.
Yes.
Here you do an approximation.
Yes, of course, and a linear guy around it. Yeah.
It's different.
Yeah.
Many of them do not appear.
So it may actually not. Well, okay, so this has bearing on the stability that you're talking about, which I don't understand. But it may be that you're not approximating the equation, but just approximating the initial data. So it would be a reasonable way to construct
In fact,
continuation by taking approximations of the initial data flow,
but,
maybe with smoothness and take a limit. But somehow the claim you're making about the stability has bearing on this, and I must say I don't understand that. So in general, this finite time singularity can't be stable because you can smoothly form.
Is the only example is
finite time singularity to a harmonic map, which has no singularity. So unless the singular time is going back to infinity, which is...
The singular time? No,
you were saying you can perturb, in the case of one bubble, you seem to be claiming you can perturb the initial data.
And you still get that.
Yes.
But not in full generality, though, right? Because you can take an initial data which generates a finite time singularity and just call it to a harmonic map.
This is absolutely... Our construction is something extremely local. Say, this function C star has an isolated zero, non-degenerate, positive dimensions. There are a lot of constraints in it. If you perturb slightly from it, the stability is not lost.
OK, so you're saying you can construct a solution, and then in a neighborhood.
In a neighborhood of that special solution, I get it. Yeah, in general, you know, maybe who knows what could happen. If there are some degenerates involved, maybe the singularities could escape. I mean, it's possible.
But then, do you include the Chang-Ding and Ye example in your examples? Does that the Chang-Ding and Ye is actually
absolutely? I mean, in fact, this in fact, their boundary condition is consistent with our divergence negative assumption. Say we analyze that. In fact, it is consistent with it.
Last question, maybe?
Well, I got a lot of answers to some of the things I wanted to ask, but one is every blow up you give is somehow isotropic. I mean, you have one target, one Q, and there's no non isotropic blow up, so you don't get elongated bubbles or anything. It's kind of a question of uniqueness.
Right. Here, I mean, we are really standing at the standard bubble, and the standard bubble is sort of isolated. In fact, the key element in the proof is the non-degeneracy of the standard bubble. Say, if you analyze the linearized equation for the harmonic map flow around it, you can invert it with Fredholm alternative, where the kernel of the linearized operator just is due to rigid motions.
Right.
So there's nothing bifurcating from it, if you wish.
Right. Right.
Hmm? So non-isotropic, I don't know. Or other type of shapes, I don't know if you can get.
But it's not nearby, at least.
Huh? Not nearby, at least. Yes.
Very good. Okay. Thank you again.
Thank you.